What God is looking for is the unity of the body of Christ.
Amen.
And you know there's all kinds of unity. But did you know that the devil is afraid of the blood of Jesus?
Amen.
The devil is afraid of the cross. The devil is afraid of the Word of God. The devil is afraid of the Holy Ghost. But did you know he's just as afraid of a church that's united? Because there's power in unity.
Turn the volume.
You see? If I was to say to you, well, what do you think about this? And we would come into agreement on that. That's good, and there's power in that. That's not what God's looking for. In His Word, He says, where two or three agree, there I am in your midst. Agree on what? That He's God. That His Word is true. This is His Word. That's what He wants us to agree on, that He is God, He is Lord, and this is His Word, this is true. We can agree that He went to the cross. We can agree that He shed His blood. We can agree on those major principal elements of Christianity. That's what He's looking for. Unity in the body of Christ. Ever since the time of the beginning of man, man has never been able to accomplish much without unity. It becomes just an individual thing. See, but God had a plan all along. He wanted mankind to come into unity with Him.
Yes.
Come into unity with His Word. Come under subjection to His Word and the power of the Holy Spirit. That was His plan all along.
Amen.
See, but God is looking for, when He gave us the Scripture, where two or three agree on what? That He's God. His Word's true. He is Almighty God. There's nothing too hard for Him. Those are the things He wants us to agree on. That's what He's looking for.
Amen.
And when we agree, there's power in agreement.
Yes. Amen.
So when a church comes into unity, when a church comes into agreement, it's a more powerful church.
Yes.
I want His full measure of power in His church. How about you?
Yes.
Hallelujah. 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 I want to see the manifestation of the power of God in such a way that we see the dead brought to life.
Amen.
I want to see His power manifested in such a way that we see instant healing in the bodies of men and women in His church. I want to see His power and His unity manifest in such a way that the Holy Spirit touches on people's hearts in such a way that they can't leave this building until they get saved.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. So I'm going to read a couple of familiar scriptures to you. Turn over to 1 Corinthians chapter 12. We'll start there. Hallelujah. The world's in a mess because there's no unity in the world anymore. We heard some of the politicians say this week, of the 28 major nations in the world, nobody's getting along. Everybody wants it their way. See, but we've learned it's not about our way.
Amen.
We've learned it's not about me, it's not about you, it's about Jesus.
Amen.
And what He's looking for in the body of Christ. He's looking for the kind of unity that we become indivisible. With liberty and justice for all. Hallelujah. Indivisible, a church that's indivisible. Because we're so bonded together in love for Jesus that the enemy cannot come in and bring division. Now look with me, if you will, verses 12 and 13. We're going to start there, the body of Christ. For as the body is one and has many members, and all the members of that one body, being many, are one body, so also is Christ. For by one Spirit we're all baptized into one body, whether we be Jew or Gentile, whether we be bond or free. Now those two verses are talking about us, the church. But now God is talking about the physical body as a metaphor for what He's looking for. Verse 14, for the body is not one member, but many. If the foot shall say, because I am not the hand, I am not of the body. Is it therefore not of the body? Anyone ask you to read this short story? I've had trouble seeing this up here. Pick up verse 16. Oh, you don't have a Bible. Okay. Tamara, would you read it? Start with verse 16.
And if the ear should say, because I am not an eye, I am not of the body. Is it therefore not of the body?
Keep going, yes.
If the whole body were an eye, where would be the ear? If the whole
That's good, thank you, right there. Hallelujah. I'm still getting used to having reading glasses, so bear with me. You see, God does not want, this was so important to him, that there be no division in the church, that he went to the cross for God. It was that important. No division in the church. Where does unity begin? Unity begins in the family. For this reason, if you're not getting along at home, you're going to have a tough time coming into union here in the church.
Come on.
I'm going to get a little personal here, man. You see, so many times, people are fussing, fighting, carrying on, and not getting along at home in the family. There's turmoil in the family. Then they wonder why they feel the way they feel when they come to church.
Yeah.
See, it begins at home. So if a husband and wife were having a discussion, and they say, well, we agree, we want to buy this new car. That's good. And there's power in it because there's agreement. See, but that's not what God's looking for. He's looking for agreement in that marriage that the two of them are going to follow this book.
Yeah. Amen.
See, I've been doing counseling since I was 32. I was licensed as a counselor, and I've done a lot of marriage counseling, and here's one rule I found out true. When the husband and wife are having trouble, if both of them are following the word of God, there will never be a divorce court.
Right.
So, the challenge is to find out what's going off track. See, and try to correct that. And those things are good. But the kind of unity that God is looking for has to begin in the family. So that you're unified when you come into the building. Then we can come together as the body of Christ and become unified under Christ Jesus. And see his power demonstrated in ways that none of us have seen. I'm believing that in these last days we're going to see that great revival. We're going to see millions of souls across America be saved. But I'm believing we're going to see a manifestation of the Holy Ghost in this church so great, this is going to blow us away. I believe he's going to let us see angels right here in this building.
Woo!
I believe we're going to see supernatural healing where people are going to get up and walk and have a walk for a while. I believe he's going to heal blind eyes. I believe he's going to heal cancer. Come on, somebody. I believe this is happening in the grace of God. Because when we come into unity with his word and who he is, he will not fail us. He will not forsake us, but he will come through and will give you your supernatural healing power.
Amen.
He will give you your miracle. There's some miracles set in the house today.
Hallelujah. Amen.
I declare.
Yeah.
I'm one of them.
Yeah.
You see, we can all raise our hand to that. But God is looking for the unity in the church in such a way that what this crazy world is doing will not hinder the church.
Amen.
Will not bring division in the church. Because the enemy likes to divide and destroy. That's what the word says. He likes to divide and destroy. The Bible says a house divided will not stand.
Yes.
Now that starts at home, doesn't it?
Yes.
But when we're solid at home, when we're behind the scripture, we're doing our best to live according to God's word, and we're united in our marriage and our family and our children, the family's united, we can come here with power because we've already agreed on it.
Yeah. Amen.
We can come here expecting to see the mighty manifestation of the Holy Spirit in this place. You know, I see so many churches that have, you look hard to find any unity. About the only thing they agree on is we got a routine here on Sunday morning. We're going to follow the routine. You know, if you ever go into a church that hands you something when they come in the door, that says to them, we're going to sing these two songs, we're going to do this, we're going to do this, we're going to do this, we're going to leave. Because they just designed Jesus out of the picture. See, that's not what he's looking for. He's looking for people that will keep open to the Holy Spirit. He's looking for people that will come into the unity of the Holy Spirit and his word and be powerful in his word. So why does God want unity so much in the church? Because he wants to give all the power that he can give to the church. He's coming back for a powerful church.
Yes.
One without spot or without wrinkle. Not a church that's been beat up and banged around, but a church walking in victory. What do you think about this? And he said, that's a good idea. Well, there's power when we marry, see? But it's not about what we agree on here. It's about the two of us agreeing on Jesus.
There you go.
There's the truth. That's what we agree on. That's the starting point. See? And then when we get saved, we become part of the body of Christ. As we read in Scripture, every part is important. We need everybody here for this church to function.
Yes.
We need everybody here to fulfill the call of God that's on this church. This isn't an evangelistic church.
Yes.
And there's a lot of ministers going out of this church. And we got to keep that going. But at the same time, each one of us as individuals, in our daily routine, in our daily meditation, in our daily time we spend with the Lord, we have to keep ourselves united with Christ.
Amen.
And His perfect will. See, there's a thing called God's perfect will, and there's a thing called God's permissive will.
That's right.
You see? Now, I don't know about you, but I don't want anything to do with His permissive will. I want to be smack dab in the middle of His perfect will, and I don't want to even consider anything else.
Amen.
Because I know that's where we're going to experience the maximum power.
Amen.
God's wanting us to do this because He wants to put more power in this church. Come on, somebody.
Yes.
Do you want to see all of His power? Do you want to see the fullness of His power manifested in this church?
Yes.
So that we can make a bigger difference in Tuolumne County.
Yes.
This county has more than the average share of people that are hurting. Homeless people, desperate people, hungry people, just have nothing to go, no place to go, nothing to have. So we have to get out of these four walls and go and let our light shine and tell the world about Jesus.
Hallelujah.
We're going to do something Saturday when we ride our quads in the parade. When we go down the street, we're going to swing to this side, we're going to go line up and say, Jesus loves you! We're going to go a little further, go this side of the street. Jesus loves you.
Amen.
Simple message.
Amen.
But a powerful one.
Yes.
Because those words are united with Jesus.
Yes.
See, that's where the power comes from.
Amen.
Unity in Christ and unity in the body. That's the power.
Amen.
And He is wanting to increase the power in this church. You know, I was thinking the other day, my. Of all the places I've been, all the churches I've been, all the services I've been, and things I've seen. And back in the old days when we used to have old Pentecostal revivals that would go on for weeks and weeks and weeks and weeks under a brush arbor. Anybody know what a brush arbor is? You see? And we had some great times. But here's what the Holy Spirit just keeps right in front of me. He says, what I have in store for you, church, now is greater than you can imagine.
Praise God.
It's greater than you can imagine. Because the world is in such a spin right now. The world's in such a turmoil. The great awakening has begun. It hadn't reached its peak yet. There's a little more trouble going to happen before it brings enough people in to make a difference. But here's my prayer twice a day. God, I get up on the mountain where I walk my dog and I say, I do this. God, today I release your power, your spirit, your word, your authority all over this nation. Bring such a shaking. Bring such an awakening that will cause the vast majority of people of America to rise up with some fight up on them and push back against the forces of darkness and take back our country. There needs to be some fight come back in the church. It's not about just coming in here and following some routine. It's about pressing on for the mark of the high calling and see what God has in store for this church. For this church. We're going to see people come through those doors that may not smell good. They may not be dressed like you think they ought to be dressed. But their soul is just as important as yours or mine.
Amen.
And we better love them.
Yes.
Because if we don't love them, they can be held at our account on Judgment Day.
Right.
If we don't preach, hallelujah, if we don't preach the gospel to them, who is? I told the pastor the other day because there's some people that had come to me out looking for a church. I said, if you're truly Pentecostal and you're hungry for more of the move of the Holy Ghost, you don't have any place to go except Harvest Fellowship.
Yeah.
And I don't say that condemning any other church. They're doing their thing. But we're not going to do their thing. We're going to do God's thing.
Yeah.
So when we come here to service, see, think about this. We're here for an hour and a half on Sunday. Some of us are here for an hour and a half on Wednesday. Three hours a week. It's all we spend together. So why is it so important that we be united in Christ? Because we got to live the rest of those hours that week in Jesus. And we better be united. We better be in the Word. We better be praying for one another. We better be calling one another, encouraging one another. There's people all around. There's people in this church today that need to hear some encouragement.
Amen.
There's nothing like when you're in the midst of the trouble and the storm is looking dark, somebody comes up to you and says, "Hey, Jesus has got been praying for you. Been praying for you. Hang on. Trust in the Lord. And He'll see you through."
Amen.
Amen. I'm talking about the kind of kinship. You know, when I was a kid growing up, we had two or three large ranches around us with big families, and I tell you what, you mess with one of those boys, you're going to fight all five of them. Well, the church needs to be the same way.
Yeah.
If the devil comes along here and messes with one of you, we all better rise up and fight.
Yeah.
Because that's what's going to take in these last days.
Yes.
We're facing some troubles, my friends. But we stay in Jesus.
Yeah.
Hallelujah. He is the author and the finisher of our faith.
Amen.
He is our provider. And He will bring us through.
Amen.
Hallelujah. And it's not just bring us through, but He'll bring us through in victory.
Yeah.
He'll bring us through having said to somebody the gospel of Jesus Christ. Mm-hmm. He'll bring us through with a smile on our face, because the world's going to go the way it's going to go. But I don't know about you, but I'm going to follow Jesus.
Amen.
Hallelujah. 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 This world is not my home. I'm just passing through. Hallelujah. This world is not my home. I'm just a pilgrim here. My citizenship is up there. My dues are paid up. And I'm ready to go. How about you? You see? So today, God is looking for a greater degree of unity in the body of Christ so that He can impart a greater degree of power in the church. He'll give you the power to say no to those fleshly temptations. He'll give you the power to say no to those things that the enemy is trying to plant in your life. No to those distractions that are out there. The world's full of them. But He wants you to be so powerful as individuals that the devil's just not going to mess with you anymore. You've heard me say, if you whoop up on the devil at least once a day, sooner or later you convince him he's wasting his time. Don't mess around with somebody else. You waste your time on that. See? He may be just hanging around and looking for something to do, but you just give him a preemptive strike. Take a shot at him first before he does you. See, did you know he's got to obey your voice? If you're filled with the Holy Spirit, the devil's got to obey you.
Come on. Amen.
The Bible says, rebuke the devil, he shall flee from you. And I see that like a bolt of lightning. He's got to go. There's no plea bargain. There's no deals we cut. Devil, out of here. You give him your command. As a child of God, he's got to obey. Will he come back and try it again? Yeah, he will, until he convinces me he's wasting time. If he can't get through to you, he'll try to get through to somebody else against you. Hello, somebody. That's why we need to be bonded together in the love of Jesus, indivisible. I don't care what happens. We need to be indivisible. We need to be dogmatic about it. We need to be hard-headed about it. No devil,
yes.
Don't do that to me. No devil. No. No is a powerful word. He needs to hear, the devil needs to hear that at least once a day. No devil. Just simply no. That's what it's going to be. Because I know my Jesus. I know my Jesus. He's the one I trust in. When I have a need, He's the one I go to. He's never failed me. He says, I'll never leave you. I'll never forsake you, no matter how you behave. As long as we keep Jesus in our heart, we're saved. He'll never leave us or forsake us. So do you see his motive now of wanting to have a higher degree of unity in the body of Christ? For a lot of reasons. The world's looking at you. The world's looking at this church. I had a policeman come up here yesterday because we've had a lot of vandalism around the church and some theft going on. And I just told him what had gone on the last year. He took a report and he looked at me. He's about my height. He's getting ready to retire from the sheriff's department. He says, you know, you guys have been under attack. I said, yeah. I said, but not from just the kids in the neighborhood. We've been under attack from the enemy. But he's a liar.
Amen.
Come to find out, the brother is a brother. He's one of the leaders in the Christian policeman's group here locally.
Yeah.
I said, hallelujah! You see, when you meet a brother or sister, then right off you got something common about it. Right off you feel a connection with. And so we just stood out here in the parking lot and talked for another 30 minutes. And I told him about what's going on in this church. I wouldn't be surprised if he didn't show up. But you see, here's the point. God wants us to hear. He has so much more to give to the church. And he wants to give this church the maximum power that it can give to the church. If we come under subjection to his word, his authority, his power, and come into the kind of unity that he's looking for. It's a sacrifice. See? Because coming into unity costs something.
Come on.
Hey, our division has to go.
Yes.
Jealousy has to go.
Come on.
Dislike has to go.
Yes.
The way you look has to go.
Yes.
Coming into unity costs you something.
Yes.
It's like we say, coming to Jesus is a free gift, but it'll cost you your life.
Amen.
See, and the more you surrender him, the more of Jesus you have. See, so all these other fleshly things that hinder us has to go because it costs something to come into unity. I don't dare. If there's somebody in this church that I didn't like for whatever reason, I better get on my face before God and say, God, forgive me.
Amen.
You see? Because it has nothing to do with what you look. You know you're looking pretty pretty today. Doesn't have anything to do with what you look. It's about the fact that you're a child of God.
Amen.
And I'm responsible for you. And you're responsible for me.
Amen.
Because we're in the same body. If you say something bad about any saved person in this church, you're talking about yourself.
Come on.
Whoa. Oh, earthquake.
Good work.
It's like you're talking about your leg. Well, I don't need this leg. Take away. No, no. See, you're talking about yourself if you're talking badly about somebody in this church that's saved in the part of this body. Now, just take that home from you. See, God is trying to get church's attention so he can impart in this church the greatness of his power so we can experience the full manifestation of who he is. Of who he is. Glory. We serve a God that loves you so much. I just hear him speaking right now. Please, put all these things aside that so easily beset you, the Bible says. All these things that so easily beset you, set them aside and come into union with me. Unity in the body of Christ. In a greater degree. Amen. In a greater degree. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Unity equals power. Unity means that we, as the body of Christ, are indivisible. Unity means going all the way together for Jesus. See, we can't have any people pulling this way, pulling that way, we all have to pull together. Having a common goal, and we're working toward a common goal. What is the common goal? Winning souls. Winning souls is our common goal. Living a life dedicated to Jesus. Staying united with one another in this church in such a way that the world just may want to go some other direction because we're indivisible under Christ Jesus. See, I'm blessed because I see when people in this church have needs, we make it known. We have a praying church. We have a praying church. We see God do miracles.
Yes.
And I would say today, I am a genuine miracle of God.
Amen.
Every one of us. It's a miracle that we got saved before we went to hell. It's a miracle. It's a miracle that God has kept us. How many times has the devil tried to kill you? A bunch. See? How many times has God spared your life? It's because He loves you. Many. See, it happens every day. It probably happened on the way to church this morning. You don't know. I was when I was stationed down in Porterville, I was teaching in the fire academy in Bakersfield. And I'd been there all week. And I was tired, and it was Friday. We finished the classes and went across the street, had lunch, and I climbed my car and headed back to Porterville and fell asleep. First time in my life that I fell asleep behind the wheel. Never fell asleep since, thank God. But my angel was in the back seat. He reached up and grabbed my shoulders. He set me up. And I'm looking at the grill of an 18-wheeler. And I jerked that wheel as hard as I could off in the grassy ditch. Why? Because my God was there. Hallelujah. 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 The old country boy had to stop his car and get outside and was dancing a little jig. I said, hallelujah. People back down the road thought I'd gone plumb nuts, but I wasn't. He spared my life. I don't know how it even happened because that truck wasn't that far from me. I mean, I was looking at the grill of that 18-wheeler. I just jerked the wheel as hard as I could to avoid it. I'll tell you what. The truck never even stopped. Because of my fault, I fell asleep went the other lane. Fixed to have a head on. Well, as it turned out, I had a head on with Jesus. I had a head on with Jesus. I said, thank you, Lord. How many here today say, thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Love you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Love you, Jesus. Ha! Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I don't know about you. You know, when I was a kid growing up, I used to read every book I could get my hands on about the frontier of the West. I would have liked to have been with the early Lewis and Clark. I would have liked to come west with Lewis and Clark. But you know, I come to know that back in those days, I said I'd like to live back in that time and live to be 100 and already be with Jesus. But you know what? I wouldn't trade now for then. Because we're in the most exciting times on the man. We're going to see the fulfillment of God's promises. We're going to see His prophecies. We're seeing them fulfilled almost every day. And He's getting ready. And one of these days, we're going to take flight. And we're going to be out of here. And when we get to heaven, say, hey, brother, you made it. Hallelujah. See? And we're going to be in the marriage supper of the Lamb. What a party. Yeah. We're going to party that. The church is the bride of Christ. Amen. There's going to be a wedding celebration like it's never been. And we'll be there with Jesus. At the end of the tribulation period, we're leaving in a rapture, but we're coming back. Amen. My Bible says Jesus riding a great white horse. Amen. And we're going to be following along. You know, if I had a dollar for every mile I put on a horseback, I'd be a wealthy man. But this horse will be glad to ride. He's coming back. And when he comes back, he's going to set up his kingdom on earth.
Amen.
He's going to rule and reign for 1,000 years. Amen. And everyone that made it to heaven is going to rule and reign with Him. Who are we going to rule and reign over? The natural people still left on the earth. Hey, God's got it all planned out.
Yes, He does.
He's got it all planned out. He knows all about it. You know, you guys know I did a lot of hunting. When I'm hunting by myself, myself when I'm hunting in a new area. I usually prefer to be by myself because I can pay attention to all the surroundings. I get my bearings. But once I've been there. And it's easy to go back. But what's it like going through life and knowing that Jesus has already been ahead of you? Know that Jesus has already been this way before. He's already walked the trail. He knows the path. He knows the way. He knows all the obstacles. He knows all the traps. He knows everything that's laid before you. But did you know he removed most of them? The ones he chooses to leave in our path is for our learning. First treatment, because without a test, there'd be no victory. Without a test, there'd be no testimony. See? Why? Because he loves us so much. Hallelujah. Satan fears the blood of Jesus, the Holy Ghost, the Word of God. Hallelujah. Requires total submission to God's call and plan for our life. And as we look at what it costs to come into total unity, all of us have to give up something. First off, we've got to get past self.
Yes.
Sometimes we just need to take the word I and cut it totally out of our vocabulary. We have to get past self. Make it about Jesus. Then if we really fall in love with Jesus, it's easy to come to unity. It's easy. And we've talked about the things that would cost you to come into total unity. But think about this for a minute. All the great rewards for coming into unity with Christ. The rewards for coming into unity with Christ Jesus. Hallelujah. There are many. Powerful church. God's full anointing. Experiencing God's supernatural works, miracles, greater revival. We're having revival already, but there's greater revival coming. Many souls are saved. Saints of God living in power and victory. God rewards unity by his power and demonstration in the church, through the church, by the church. God says, I have more to give you. I have more to show you in these last days. How many believe that we're going to see that last day great, great revival?
Amen.
It's going to come in 12 weeks out.
Yes.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. When it does, we need to be ready.
Yes.
We need to be so united that the enemy can't send a wolf in amongst the flock.
Amen.
Twice since we've been in this church, we moved in here in April of 2012. And twice the Lord has spoken and said, I'm going to bring you another group of people. I'm going to be a larger church, but watch out, there's a wolf among them. And that happened. We identified the person, and we politely asked him to leave. Because we will not tolerate that kind of division. We have to protect the house of God. We have to protect the people of God. Because the enemy is always looking for opportunity to divide. And destroy. That's his business.
That's cool.
I don't want to see anybody come to this church and not feel the presence of the Lord. I don't want to see anybody come to this church and not feel the love of Jesus. We love them unconditionally, no matter what they look like, what they sound like, where they've been. I don't care where they've been. I just want to know they're ready to accept Jesus.
Amen.
See. I had several people working for me that had spent long prison terms for high offenses. And they want to come and tell me all about it. I said, wait. I don't care. Are you ready to love Jesus? Are you ready to accept Jesus? None of that doesn't matter. See, my Bible says, once you come to Jesus, your slate just got wiped clean.
Amen.
He says, your sins are taken and forgiven of you and cast into the sea of forgetfulness, never be remembered against you ever again. Then they put up a no fishing sign for the devil. That's the God we serve. So I want to challenge you today. Go ahead and stand on your feet. Hallelujah. Unified in Christ. You know, I remember back on the ranch growing up, and if we hired somebody to work on a ranch, one of the questions we asked them, we'd say, "Are you ready to ride for the brand? Are you ready to defend the brand of this ranch?" My dad's brand was OC. Oscar Cavender. James Oscar. Are you ready to ride for the brand? The brand is Jesus. Church, are you ready to ride for Jesus?
Yes.
Hallelujah. I want to ask you this morning, as they begin to play, it's just a sign of surrender to God's plan for unification in this church. I want to fill the throne of this church up. Just come as an expression today. Say, "Lord, you can count me in. I want to be totally unified to you and to this body of Christ." Come on, join me up here this morning. As a sign of dedication, I want to be fully unified in the body of Christ. Hallelujah. 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 Praise Jesus. Take your hand all the way across the church. Join hands across the church. Thank you, Jesus. Just make a triple row here today, all the way across the church. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Glory, Jesus. Glory, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. There is power in unity. As we say, just repeat after me this morning. Lord Jesus, I stand before you today.
I pledge my life anew.
I ask that you unite us together. The bond of Jesus Christ. The love of Jesus Christ. But we are so strongly bound together. That we are indivisible. Under Christ Jesus. We receive your power.
We receive your anointing.
We go forth.
Win souls.
Change Swan County. Make a difference in America.
Give him a praise in the house.